Okay, good morning students. This is Arpit Thakur, and as per the request of most of the students, I'm trying to deliver this lecture in a video mode, and since there are limitations with the meetings or video lectures because of the internet connectivity, I have to upload this video online, whether through YouTube or I'll share it directly with you. And in case of any doubts regarding the same video or the same content, you can ask me. Your queries are welcome, your doubts are welcome through any mode. Either you can comment in down the video or you can ask your questions on LPO live. Fine. So let us just start this lecture, today's lecture, and we'll see what happens, what things are going to be covered in under this lecture. But before that, I want you to go backward in the last lecture. So in the last lecture, we started Unit 6, and Unit 6 basically is about, if you see in the IPs or the syllabus, Unit 6 is about basically the applications of automatic transmissions. Okay, automatic transmissions. After midterm, we started with the automatic transmission system. There we learned about different types of gear trains, different types of gear boxes used for automatic transmission system. Mostly these are apicyclic gear boxes. We have seen different types of gear boxes, including Wilson gear box, or the basic starting where the apicyclic gear trains were used. That was a 40 model that we have seen in that unit. Okay, then we had moved forward, and in a unit where we were discussing about hydrostatic drives. So again, those were also can be called as automatic transmission systems. So we had seen the basics of the automatic transmission system, that what are the basic gear arrangements. And even before midterm, I think during second unit or so, no, that during third unit, we discussed about fluid couplings and torque converters. Those are also basics of automatic transmissions. So we had learned about a lot of basics of different types, or we had learned a lot of basics about different types of automatic transmission systems. So in this unit, we'll try to explore more about them by different applications, by maybe different manufacturers are using different types of automatic transmission system, and what are the historic development of the automatic transmission applications. That we are going to learn under this unit, and that I had shared in with you in the last lecture content also. There I have presented that what are the needs of automatic transmission system and what is the principle of automatic transmission system, along with the scope of this unit. So I want to take you there and just quickly recap what were the important points we did there. Okay, so these are the points I've shared with you in the last lecture. What is the need of automatic transmission system? You can very well see that what is the meaning of automatic transmission? That means it is self-shifting. Self-shifting means a user need not to change the gear ratios manually again and again based on the driving conditions. It should be self-shifted. Fine. So that is automatic. Now, if it is possible to self-shift the automatic transmission, there are many outcomes can be occurred, and those could be advantageous, like we'll discuss some of them. Okay, so that is the same point discussed over here. Also, driver does not need to shift the gears manually. It allows the engine to run at the optimum speed. Why optimum speed? Because it depends upon the engine requirement, the gears will shift automatically. Okay, then we discuss some of the stages also. Okay, there are hydraulic components, hydraulic transmission system, like in case of torque converters or fluid couplings. We have different types of popular automatic transmission units. Okay, other than that, there are some CVTs available there. There are automated manual transmissions. Now, what are automated manual transmission? Like the ones we have discussed in like in case of Wilson gearbox or epicyclic gearbox, those are called as automated manual transmission. There you have to shift the levers, but not for setting all the gear ratios, just for, like, you may have seen in different vehicles like drive, neutral and reverse condition. So just if you put the vehicle into the drive condition, forward drive condition, the gear ratios will be adjusted according to the speed and the torque requirement of the vehicle. Okay, now what are CVTs and what could be the difference between CVT and an automated manual transmission is, in very basic terms, CVTs provide an N number of speed ratio. N number of speed ratio means it doesn't offer discrete speed ratio, it offers a continuous speed ratios. Discrete and continuous, I hope the terminology is clear to you. Discrete means in batches, in parts, in splits, but continuous is without any gaps. So there will be a continuous transmission, continuous change of the speed ratios available in CVTs, but in automated gear transmission you may have gear ratio like 2:1, then 3:1. There is a gap between 2:1 and 3:1. It could be 2.5:1 also, but that cannot be achieved during the automated transmission system. But in CVT, you can go up to 2.5:1, 2.8:1, 2.3:1. So that is the basic advantage of CVTs. Okay. Now, yes, this is one of the very important advantage of or need of the automatic transmission, that some of us who are not physically able, there may be some kind of disability with the people in their legs, so they are not able to press the clutch again and again and control the vehicle's automatic transmission system in case of manual transmission system. So such type of automatic transmission system allow such people to be able to drive the vehicles, because in that case the person has not to push the clutches again and again, and he can majorly focus on driving or controlling the vehicle steering system. And it could also lead to more focus of the driver, as he is not getting tired by shifting the gears or by pressing the clutches, and he can even drive the vehicle in a slow speed, on a slow speed, because the clutch control has been eliminated. That is what I was discussing here also. And one of the major disadvantage of such automatic transmission system is that most of the automatic transmission system relies on the hydraulic transmissions. And with hydraulic transmissions, we have seen in unit 3 also, like in unit 3 we have seen that automatic transmission requires, or like in case of fluid couplings, they require fluid transmission, and because of which there is a possibility of large amount of slip available, so which can be a reason of a lot of power loss or the torque loss, which will lead to the reduction on the in the efficiency, right? So this could be one of the disadvantage. Now, talking about the principles of automatic transmission, based upon the different type of transmission available, there could be different principles. Like in case of automatic manual transmission, as we discussed, there is a discrete speed ratio. So we need to shift the gears by applying brakes on different gears, as we have seen in Wilson gearbox or the epicyclic gearbox. And while CVT, there we are using a slipping belt system. During the lab in the previous semester, we have seen the working of the CVTs also, that in that case there will be a belt slipping on a cylinder which is having a varying diameter or varying radius. So because of which, if the diameter is changing, we can change the speed ratio or gear ratio. We will see the CVT in the coming classes, don't worry. So that was it about the needs and the principles of transmission, and this is the scope of this unit, that we are going to discuss some of the transmission system used by some prime manufacturers around the globe. So that was the recap of the previous lecture. Let us just start the today's lecture. So in today's lecture, we are going to discuss one of the type of automatic transmission system initially designed or given by General Motors, which was denoted by the name of Chevrolet Turboglide transmission. So Chevrolet Turboglide transmission, how it is revolutionary in field of automatic transmission system is, like previously, even with the presence of automatic transmission system, the driver has to control the gear levers, either in driving condition or neutral condition. He has to do some work to, change the gear lever, and it was a, you can say, the change of speed ratio, the changing of gear was not as very smooth. It was harsh, it was rough, it was not smooth. Fine. So smoothening of the gear shifting is, you can say, very well achieved by Chevrolet Turbo Glide transmission. Okay. You can read the first point also, that it is a type of a CVT. It is a type of continuous variable automatic transmission. So it's one of the type of the CVT which is originally developed in 1957, and it was first applied to a Chevrolet V8 passenger cars. Okay. Now, talking about the basics of turbo glides, the construction of the turbo glide is similar as the construction of a torque converter, you can say. But unlike torque converter, where we have four, majorly three components are there in torque converter. You can think of them like there is a pump impeller driven by the engine, then there will be a turbine, and between turbine and pump there will be a stator mounted over a freewheel. Fine. So what was the function of stator? The function of the stator was like, it will drive the fluid which is coming out of the turbine in a suitable direction for the impeller, so that the impeller can be driven positively, and it will add to the input of the vehicle. Okay, so it will lead to torque multiplication. So that was the basic advantage of torque converter when compared with fluid couplings. Here also turbo glide is also similar to the torque converter, except instead of three elements, turbo glide is having five elements. You can see five elements are there in the turbo glide. There are five elements in the turbo glide, and these are like, there will be, instead of one pump, one turbine, the turbo glide is having some more turbines than what torque converter has. We will see in the coming slides. See, this is the construction of a turbo glide transmission box. Let us just try to observe this construction for a while. Okay. Now if I see, this part will be acting as a torque converter or a fluid coupling, and this part is having different gears. Okay, basically a Chevrolet turbo glide transmission box consists of two epicyclic gear train. This is epicyclic gear train 1, this is epicyclic gear train 2. Fine. You can see S1, S2, A1, A2, R1, R2. Basically S1 and S2 are the sun gears of epicyclic gear trains, A1 and A2 are the annulus or the ring gear for the gear trains, and R1 and R2 are the planet gears for the gear trains. Okay. Now apart from this, there are certain C's also. You can see C1, C2, C3 and C4. Fine. So C1, C2, C3 and C4 are acting as a clutch. It's same clutch packs, same as the Wilson, in the Wilson gearbox we were using clutch packs to hold the different gears stationary at different point of time. So here also the same function has been performed by these clutch packs, C1, C2, C3 and C4. Okay. Now main input members, you can see this is the shaft D. Shaft D is the main input shaft, and shaft H is the main output shaft. Okay. Now coming to this fluid coupling part, you can see very well that this is the pump. This is the pump, which is an engine driven pump. Okay. And there are T1, T2, T3. Okay. So these are the turbines, T1, turbine 1, turbine 2 and turbine 3. So all of these turbines are connected with different units in the gearbox. Okay, turbine T1 may be connected with some other unit, turbine T2 and turbine T3 may be connected with other units. Now how they are connected? They are connected in such a way that they can offer different gear ratios when driven separately. Like if suppose T1 is driven, so it may offer a lower speed ratio or higher torque ratio, but when T2 is driven, it can relatively offer a greater speed ratio or lesser torque ratio, and T3 will be acting as a direct drives. So we'll see how it is connected here. Okay, like you can see the connection of T1 has been shown over here. T1 is connected with this shaft D. Okay, where this shaft D is having sun gear S2 as the drive gear. Fine. So T1 is connected with the shaft D, and shaft D is driving S2. Okay, so that is the first connection. Second connection you can see T2. T2 is connected with the sleeve. You can see this sleeve. Okay. And just a second. You can see this sleeve. Okay. So T2 is connected with the sleeve. It is named as sleeve E. Fine. So see, sleeve E is further connected to A1. Okay. The sleeve E is further connected to A1. So it's clear that T2 is connected to sleeve E, which is further connected to annulus gear or the ring gear A1 of first epicyclic gear train. Okay. Then the connection of this T3, this T3 is connected with, you can see this dark shading. So this T3 is connected with this sleeve G1. Okay. So this sleeve G1 is further connected to clutch C1, and from clutch C1 this is further connected with R2, and from R2 it is connected with the output shaft H. So T3 is directly connected to the output shaft H via sleeve G, clutch C, R2, okay, and then H. So all of these combinations will be used for obtaining different gear ratios. Okay. We'll see one by one. Like initially when this pump is driving, initially it will drive T1 turbine. T1 is designed in such a way that it will be a bigger turbine, and the blade spacing will be more as compared to spacing of the blades of T2 and T3. So when this turbine T1 will be driven, okay, it will try to drive the shaft D, and sun gear S2 will be driven due to this. Now when the sun gear S2 will be driven, okay, the sun gear S2 will be driven, and it will offer a low speed and higher torque in this case when the T1 is driven. Okay, but before that, let's just discuss few more points about these stator. Stator is mounted over, you can see F1. F1 is a free wheel one, first free wheel. So stator is mounted over free wheel F1. There are F2 and F3 also available. So what is the function of F2 and F3 over here? F2 is connected with S1. So F2 will not allow the rotation of S1 in the opposite direction, and F3 is connected with annulus gear A2. So F3 will not allow the movement of annulus gear A2 in the reverse direction, and both of F2 and F3 are always in action due to this clutch C2, because C2 will remain engaged every time, fine, unless neutral or the reverse condition. Fine. So because of which F2, F3 will not allow S1 and A2 in the reverse direction, and F1 will not allow the stator to move in the opposite direction. Okay. Now when we were discussing about the rotation or the speed ratio, T1 will allow the movement of S2 as the driving gear, and then this S2 will try to give the output at a lower speed. So H will rotate at lower speed as compared to D, so it will give the first gear ratio. But as the driver is pressing the accelerator pedal, or if it is throttling the vehicle, fine, this pump will start rotating with higher speed, due to which it will start giving out the oil at higher velocity. So due to this higher velocity or higher pressure, what will happen, the fluid will start surpassing T1. Okay, the fluid will pass across the T1 blades of the T1, because I have told you that the blades, the spacing in T1 is not very close. Fine. So the fluid will start surpassing the blades of T1, and it will activate the turbine T2. Now as the turbine T2 starts, you can see the turbine T2 is connected with the help of the sleeve E. It is connected with A1. Okay. So it will start driving A1, and A1, it will start driving this A1, and see, this A1 will start driving the planet gear R1, and which is further connected to, see, with this R1 is connected to H. So one movement is given over here, and the rotation of A1 or R1 will start driving S1 also. So S1 is connected to this annulus gear A2, so it will also add up to the speed of the vehicle, and the speed of the output will be relatively higher as compared to the previous configuration. Fine. But as soon as the accelerator pedal is pressed, or the throttling has been increased on the vehicle, fine, so fluid will start surpassing T1 and T2, and it will activate turbine T3.
Now you can see that turbine T3 is directly connected with the output shaft H. Okay, so what will happen here? When this happens, when the speed, when the throttling happens over here, so this clutch C1 will be pressed. So clutch C1 will be locked or engaged. In that case, this turbine, whatever the rotation of turbine T3 will show, the same rotation will be, you can say, replicated by this whole assembly C1, and from C1 to R2 and from R2 to H. So this will be like in the case that the rotation of T3 is replicated by H. So this is a case of a direct drive. In this case, the vehicle is rotating at the maximum speed and you can say minimum torque. Okay. So this is the condition, or I can say this, these are the three different speed ratios and gear ratios achieved by turboglide mechanism. Now what happens during the reversing condition? Okay, so during the reversing condition, what happens here is this clutch C4 is pressed. When the clutch C4 is pressed, what will happen? Let's see. When the C4 is pressed and other clutch packs C1, C2 and C3 will be disengaged. So what will happen in this case? In this case is pump will be driving T1, turbine T1, and this turbine T1, as I have already told you, this is directly connected to shaft input shaft D, and input shaft D will drive S2. So when the S2 is driven, it will try to drive R2 and A2. So if the annulus gear A2 is driven, so A2 will try to drive S1. Okay. And this S1 will try to drive the planet R1, okay, and A1. But you know that A1 is connected to C4. So when this A1 is locked, the rotation of A1 annulus gear first is restricted, prevented. So what will happen? Whatever the rotation of S1 is making, opposite to that of rotation of S1, R1 will rotate opposite to S1. So R1 will start rotating opposite to S1. Okay. So this R1 will drive H in the reverse direction. Okay. Now you may say that S2 was driving, and due to S2, and suppose S2 and R2 are driving in the same direction because A2 was not locked. So A2 is driving in the forward direction, and R2 is driving in the forward direction, and R1 is driving in the reverse direction. So how can you say that this is a reverse condition? So what I can say is the torque on R1 will be greater than the torque on R2 because of the set gear ratios, because of the design of the gears. So torque of R1 is greater than torque of R2. So overall, there will be a reverse movement achieved on H, because R1 is greater than R2, the torque of R1 is greater than R2. So in this way, a reverse gear mechanism or reverse condition is achieved in case of Chevrolet Turboglide transmission box. I would recommend you to go through the whole explanation again, replay this video again, and try to understand the working. But for your ease, I have explained everything over here in the text also, that what is the how the different parts are connected, what is the construction. You can read them out. Okay, then the working of the Chevrolet Turboglide system is discussed in three different gear ratios. Okay, and in the reverse condition also. I want to take your interest in one of the, you can say, point where we will see the advantage of turboglide mechanism. So let's see what is that advantage. Now I want you to read this paragraph. This paragraph is very important. See what happens. Let's assume a condition where when you are driving down on a hill, fine, down from a hill. So when you are driving down from a hill, what happens is you have to apply a lot of brakes to control the movement of the vehicle, and this would this leads to a tiring driving condition, because the driver gets tired because of applying brakes again and again, and to control the speed. And again, this is not good for brakes also. Brake fading may occur. So how does a Chevrolet Turboglide system helps in this case? Okay, we'll see like this here. See, this annulus A2 is prevented. Now we have seen in the construction also that that this A2 is, the rotation of A2 is prevented in the reverse direction by F3, and the rotation of S1 in the reverse direction is prevented by F2. Okay, so what happens over here? What happens over here is, so what happens here is, see, when such condition occurs when you are driving down on a hill, this the reverse rotation of A2 and S1 is prevented by F2 and F3, free wheel F2 and F3, and clutch C3 will be engaged. Now, when the clutch C3 will be engaged, what will happen? It will prevent the rotation of A2 in the forward direction also. So A2 cannot move in the forward direction because the clutch C3 is engaged. A2 cannot move in the forward direction, and it will try to decrease the speed of the output gears. So output rotation will be tried to reduce. The rotation speed of the output gear will be reduced, and a kind of a braking system has been effectively introduced in the transmission system itself. So there will be a transmission braking system is also achieved due to this kind of construction. Okay.